السلام عليكم. الحمد لله، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وسلم. الله يرزقنا حسن النية. May Allah grant us all the sincere intentions. Do you hear well in the back? Is it okay? Are you hearing? MashaAllah. You know, we started the past time in the winter session. We were explaining the book of As-Sirat al-Mustaqim. But for many reasons, we are going to, instead of continuing now in As-Sirat, we are going to go again over Al-Mukhtasar, the book of Al-Mukhtasar, starting from the beginning and finishing whatever we can finish in this session, and then we'll continue in the winter session and so on as usual, inshallah ta'ala. Why Al-Mukhtasar? Because this is the book that we need it all the time. We review in it, we teach in it. I'm not saying that As-Sirat is not needed, but we'll start with Al-Mukhtasar, then we'll continue, inshallah, in As-Sirat. Also, we are going to go according to a certain method, if you want, which means that I will choose from among you certain people, and every day they will get an extra session in which they will not, and anyone who wants to attend this session is welcome. But I will choose certain people because I want to ask them questions about all what they took during the day. So they will be examined, if you want, on daily basis. So whomever wants to be examined with them, I don't mind. He or she is welcome. But there are certain people that will be examined. I hope, and inshallah this is how we are going to do it, that during the rest of the summer, yani before the next session, the winter session, that everyone, every group in their region, they will review what they took, and according to a certain procedure that Hajj Umar will inform you about, inshallah, in time, they will be examined also, everyone in their regions. I think this is a good way to follow. Otherwise, you take the information and then you do not know if everyone is understanding. You want to be sure about how far everyone understands, how good everyone understands what they are acquiring, and how good they can express, can they express it in the proper way or not? This is important. This is a serious matter. This is related to the religion. So it needs certain effort. This is why we will start with Al-Mukhtasar from the beginning and then we'll continue, inshallah, as far as we can reach. Is it clear? And I urge everyone to take this matter very seriously. I think it's time to do that. Now, if the people who attend the session, the people who are tested, if you want, if they answer, how do I say it? If they do well, then inshallah, if I can, I think I will. Allah yassir. If I have enough effort, then in the evening at night, you'll get a reward. So we'll go over a different book, inshallah. A nice book that doesn't need much of thinking. Which is all, it was read on Sheikh Abdullah. It contains stories about Al-Awliya with the chain of narrators. It is a very nice book, really. But this depends. If they study well and they answer properly, then you'll get this reward. If they don't, then all of you will suffer the consequences. So you know who to get in this case. In this case, inshallah. Boy. And I will ask at the beginning of every session, as usual. It doesn't mean I will not ask questions about the previous session, no. But that's on top. One more thing, when between the sessions, I urge you to study. To study well and review well. If you don't do that, you will miss. And you will not be able to review everything. Yani if you say, okay, in the evening I'll do that, most likely you will not be able to do it in the evening properly. You will start, maybe you will start for half an hour, for an hour, putting good effort, reviewing well, then you will start going faster over the material, leaving out some things, not memorizing well other things. Usually this is what happens. So review after every class. Allah yubariku fikum. This is how the knowledge is acquired. This is how the knowledge becomes, how do you say it? Well rooted in one's heart. I told you before about Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi. Didn't I? Yeah, I did. He was a very famous Shafi'i scholar. He was studying, when he started studying, he was studying in a religious school. It had steps. And after every lesson that he took, he would start with one mas'ala, one case. He would start from the first step. He would stand on it and review that case. Then he would go to the second step and review the case. Then to the third, then to the fourth, until he reached the upper one. Then he would go down in the same way. This is for every case. For each and every case. So, that's how the knowledge became well-rooted in his heart. This is the way to do that. MashaAllah. طيب. If you have the English summary, the explanation in English, I think that makes it easier for you to review in it also, to add remarks. If يعني it makes it easier instead of writing everything. It's يعني I think this is beneficial. And this is beneficial. There is something else that you can check whatever case which I mentioned and it's not there, so maybe we can add it. Yani, it's very beneficial to. طيب خلونا نبلش. Let us start. الحمد لله رب العالمين. وصلى الله على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. I'll start with the introduction of the book also. What I'm explaining is a summary of Al-Bughya. So it is a summary of Al-Bughya. It's not Al-Bughya itself, it's a summary of Al-Bughya. And I advise you to work with this explanation, not to go and review in Al-Bughya. There are many things that needs to be clarified. It has a Q at the beginning. Clarified in Al-Bughya. If you read it just as is, you are not sure what the person who's listening, what did he understand from what you are reading. You are not explaining. Some people, they do that. They say, we are not explaining, we read it as it is. Well, you read it as it is, you don't know the person who's listening what he understood from that. Did he understand the proper meaning or not? Some issues, they need some restrictions, and sometimes they are not mentioned there. There are several issues. I don't advise you to use Al-Bughya when you explain wherever you are, to review or the like, to use Al-Bughya, all of it. So I advise you to use what I'm going to give you, inshallah, in this issue, in reviewing. So I will start with the introduction. مقدمة. الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. وبعد، فإن الله تبارك وتعالى يقول: فاعلم أنه لا إله إلا الله واستغفر لذنبك وللمؤمنين والمؤمنات. فاعلم، هذا خطاب للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، والمراد أثبت يا محمد على اعتقادي أنه لا إله إلا الله، وإلا فإن النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام كان يعلم أنه لا إله إلا الله، إنما المقصود اثبت على اعتقادي أنه لا إله إلا الله، واستغفر لذنبك وللمؤمنين والمؤمنات. هذه الآية استدل بها العلماء الذين أجازوا على الأنبياء الصغائر التي ليس فيها خسة ولا دناءة، لأن العلماء علماء أهل السنة في هذه المسألة على قسمين: بعد إجماعهم، بعد أن أجمعوا على أن الأنبياء لا يصدر منهم كفر ولا كبيرة، اختلفوا في صدور الصغيرة التي ليس فيها خسة ولا دناءة منهم. قالوا إجماع أن الأنبياء لا يكفرون، إجماع أن الأنبياء لا يحصل منهم ذنب كبير، إجماع أن الأنبياء لا يحصل منهم فعل خسيس أو فيه دناءة. أما الصغائر التي ليس فيها خسة ولا دناءة فقد اختلفوا فيها. الأكثرون قالوا تجوز على الأنبياء، بعضهم قال تجوز نادرا قبل النبوة، بعضهم قال بعد النبوة. ثم الذين قالوا بعد النبوة قالوا يسرعون بالتوبة قبل أن يقتدي بهم أحد من الناس. وبعض العلماء وهم الأقل قالوا الذنوب الصغيرة التي ليس فيها خسة ولا دناءة لا تصدر من النبي من الأنبياء كغيرها من الذنوب. قالوا لأن مأمورون باتباعهم، فلو كان يحصل منهم الذنب الصغير لاتبعناهم فيه. الأولون قالوا هذا لا يكون، لأنهم يتوبون قبل أن يقتدي بهم أحد من الناس. هلا قول الأكثرين هو الموافق لظواهر الآيات والأحاديث. وإن كان الآخرون أيضا هم من علماء أهل السنة. Allah Ta'ala said in the 19th verse of Surah Muhammad, فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ. The first part of this verse, فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ means, O Muhammad, adhere to the creed that there is no God but Allah. In this verse, the term fa'lam is used, which literally means no. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew that there is no God except Allah. So what it means really, adhere to that conviction, adhere to that creed. Now using the term fa'lam, indicates the importance of the knowledge. So although what is meant adhere to the creed that there is no God but Allah, the term fa'lam is used to indicate also the importance of the knowledge. The other part, the second part, واستغفر لذنبك وللمؤمنين والمؤمنات, means ask forgiveness for your sin and the sins of the believers, males and females. It does not say ask forgiveness for all their sins. Because it is not permissible for one to ask forgiveness for all the sins of all the believers. Because you know that some of the believers are going to be tortured in hellfire. As it is mentioned in Al-Quran and Al-Hadith. So if you want, instead of saying as, what did we say in the in expressing the meaning of the verse? Ask forgiveness. Okay, ask forgiveness for yourself and for the believers, males and females. Put it this way. So no one would think for all the sins. So ask forgiveness for yourself and for the believers, males and females. Now this verse stands as, this verse is a reference for the scholars who said that the prophets might rarely commit a small sin. You know that there is a consensus among the scholars that the prophet does not commit blasphemy, does not commit an enormous sin, and does not commit a sin that contains meanness. But what about the small sins that do not entail meanness and the like? The Muslim scholars, I mean the scholars of Ahl Sunnah, have two opinions about this matter. Some of the scholars and those are a minority among them, especially a minority among the Salaf. They said even those sins that do not contain meanness that do not show low characters, they said the prophets do not commit them, do not. It is impossible for them to commit such sins. Even they said the prophets do not do anything which is disliked, even. Not even a sin, even if it is disliked. They said a prophet does not do that. They said because we are ordered to follow them. And if the prophet commits an act which is disliked or an act which is sinful, then the people would follow them in that, would follow this prophet in that. This is what they said. Now, most of the scholars said that according to the apparent meanings of many, of several verses and hadith, the Prophet might rarely commit a sin which is a small sin and does not show a low character. They referred to verses like the aforementioned verse to support their saying. They replied to what the previous ones mentioned by saying, although they said, yes, we are ordered to follow the Prophet, but if a Prophet commits a small sin, he repents quickly before anyone follows him in doing that sin. Now, some of those scholars said the Prophet might commit a small sin before prophethood. Some said after prophethood. The saying which is closer to the apparent meanings of the verses in Al-Quran and the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is the saying of the majority. هذه الآية فيها أيضا إشارة إلى فضل العلم، لأن فيها ذكر العلم قبل ذكر العمل الذي أشير إليه بالاستغفار. فاعلم أنه لا إله إلا الله، هذا إشارة إلى العلم وبالتحديد إلى علم العقيدة. واستغفر لذنبك، هذا إيش؟ عمل يعمله المؤمن. ففيه إشارة، هذه الآية فيها إشارة إلى تقديم العلم على العمل. لذلك الإمام البخاري قال باب العلم قبل العمل، ثم ذكر افتتح هذا الباب بذكر هذه الآية، لأن فيها الإشارة إلى ذلك. Because the term فعلم is used in this verse contains or this verse indicates that one should acquire the knowledge before practicing. Because the knowledge is mentioned first in this ayah, and especially it refers to the knowledge of al-aqidah, of the creed. And then the act of asking forgiveness is mentioned afterwards. So this verse indicates that one should acquire the knowledge before being involved in doing something. When I say the knowledge, that this means the religious knowledge pertaining to what he wants to do. And this is why Al-Imam Al-Bukhari, in his book Al-Sahih, he made a chapter with the title, Knowledge is Before Practicing or Acting. Then the first thing he mentioned in this chapter was this verse. So immediately after the title, he mentioned this verse. Why? Because it indicates, it implies that it is important to acquire the knowledge before starting practicing. ويقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فيما رواه البيهقي طلب العلم فريضة على كل مسلم أي أن طلب العلم الشرعي فريضة على كل مسلم على كل مسلم أي على كل شخص مسلم ذكر أو أنثى. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said, acquiring the knowledge, that is the knowledge of the religion, is an obligation upon every Muslim. This means whether male or female. وليس المراد أنه يجب معرفة جميع مسائل الدين بتفاصيلها. لا. يجب أن يعرف الشخص الفرض العيني، إنما المراد أن هناك قدرا من علم الدين يجب معرفته على كل مسلم مكلف، وهو الذي يسميه العلماء الفرض العيني من علم الدين. أما الزيادة على ذلك فمعرفته فرض كفاية، فلولا نفر من كل طائفة منهم فرقة ليتفقهوا في الدين. إذن لابد أن يكون في كل طائفة في كل ناحية من تفقه في الدين، من حصل الفرض الكفائي من حيث التفقه في الدين. أما الفرض العيني فيجب على كل مسلم مكلف تحصيله. It is not meant by this hadith that every accountable Muslim has to acquire all the matters pertaining to the knowledge of the religion. No. What is meant is to acquire the personal obligatory knowledge. What he needs, the knowledge that he needs. What exceeds that, which is فرض كفاية among the knowledge of the religion, the communal obligation among the knowledge of the religion, some Muslims have to acquire it. It is a communal obligation among the Muslims in every region to acquire فرض الكفاية if they neglect that, then all of them are sinful. If some of them do that, then the others are not sinful. This is enough. As Allah said in Al-Quran, فلولا نفر من كل طائفة منهم فرقة ليتفقهوا في الدين. In this verse, Allah ordered the Muslims that among every group of them, in every region, some of them they need to acquire more than the personal obligatory knowledge among the knowledge of the religion. Why? For the others, then, if they need what exceeds the personal obligatory knowledge of the religion, then they can come back to them and ask them, and they can benefit them. وَلَقَدْ وَجَدْنَا كِتَابَ الْمُحَدِّثِ الْحَافِظِ الشَّيْخِ عَبْدِ اللَّهِ الْهَرَوِيِّ الَّذِي سَمَّاهُ مُخْتَصَرَ عَبْدِ اللَّهِ الْهَرَوِيِّ الْكَافِلَ بِعِلْمِ الدِّينِ الضَّرُورِيِّ كِتَابًا مُخْتَصَرًا مُفْرَدًا فِي هَذَا الْعِلْمِ. Then the introduction continues to say, we found the book of the Muhaddith, the Faqih Muhaddith, Shaykh Abdullah Al-Harari, which he called the summary of Abdullah Al-Harari. A unique summary in this knowledge. أخذه من كتاب سلم التوفيق لعبد الله بن الحسين بن طاهر. He took it, or he summarized, this book is a summary of the book called سلم التوفيق, authored by a Yemeni scholar, Abdullah ibn al-Husayn ibn Tahir, مع حذف مواضع منه أو تبديلها. Sometimes Sheikh Abdullah omitted areas from the book of Sulam al-Tawfiq. Sometimes he changed it. وزيادة فوائد, sometimes he added some extra beneficial information. فرأينا أن نطبعه لعظيم فائدته. ولما كانت هذه الفائدة لا يحصلها طالبها إلا بشرح ألفاظها رأينا أن نطبع شرحه. Now, the book of Sheikh Abdullah, the summary, is really a unique one. Easily, you can go back to other books authored to talk about the personal obligatory knowledge of the religion, and you will immediately notice that it contains many information which is not, many types of information which is not in other books. And it encompasses almost the personal obligatory knowledge of the religion. Of course, in some areas it contains more information, more than the personal obligatory knowledge. And this is why we are going over explaining this book. بقي الإشارة إلى أن حديث طلب العلم فريضة على كل مسلم رواه البيهقي وضعفه بعض الحفاظ, لكن بالنظر إلى مجموع طرقه يتقوى. لذلك حكم عليه الحافظ المزي بأنه حسن لغيره. Let me add one thing, that the aforementioned hadith, طلب العلم فريضة على مسلم, على كل مسلم, which means acquiring the religious knowledge is an obligation, that is the personal obligatory knowledge, is an obligation upon every accountable Muslim. This hadith is narrated by Al-Bayhaqi. Some top scholars of hadith, Huffaz, they said it is da'if, it is weak. But taking in consideration, when they said that, they did not take in consideration, they were not talking about all the different routes of this hadith. Taking in consideration all the different routes of the hadith, then this hadith becomes a strong one. And this is why Al-Hafiz Al-Mizzi judged it to be strong. He said, حَسَنٌ لِغَيْرِهِ, حَسَن for other than itself, which means strong. إلى هنا أحد له سؤال. Up till here, do you have any questions about what we mentioned? I'm عجل. المزي. لا بالزاي. معروف المزة مشهورة نسبة إليها. أيوة هي نفسها. المزي referring to an area next to Damascus called المزة. Very famous area. It has a big jail, a famous jail in it. That's why it's famous. هكا ليس كل معصية فيها خسة. تقول له لأنها لا تدل على دناءة في النفس. هذا معروف الخسة, دناءة النفس معروفة. أوكي. An example of those, Al-Qadi Iyad, in his book Al-Shifa, he copied the consensus that of the scholars that a prophet does not commit an enormous sin and a prophet does not commit blasphemy. Al-Qadi Iyad fi Al-Shifa, when Sadruddin? Sadruddin, manu hun? Wainu we? صدر الدين تفهم انجليزي لما بحكي انجليزي؟ يا صدر الدين عندما اتكلم بالانجليزية تفهم كل ما اقول؟ تقريبا. وفايز؟ وفايز اقل. القاضي عياض ممن نقل الإجماع على أن الأنبياء معصومون من الكفر والكبائر, ثم قال بعد أن نقل الإجماع, قال والأكثر من العلماء, الأكثرون من العلماء أجازوا عليهم الصغائر, أي التي ليس فيها خسة ولا دناءة. قال والأقلون لم يجيزوها. ثم هو مشى مع الأقلين. فالقاضي عياض مثال عن هؤلاء. قاضي عياض mentioned in his book Al-Shifa that there is a consensus among the scholars, the Muslim scholars, that A prophet does not commit an enormous sin nor a great sin, nor blasphemy. He said, most of the Muslim scholars said it might happen. It is not religiously impossible for one of them to commit a small sin. That is a sin that does not show meanness and low character. He said a minority among the scholars said even that they don't commit it, even the small sin. And Al-Qadi Iyad went according to the minority even. Yani he mentioned that most of the scholars said they might, and then he adopted, he went according to the other saying. So this is an example of one of them. Qadi Iyad is one of them.
تعيبني هالكتاب الإنجليزي مشان المتن.
في كتاب الشفاء ذكر in his book الشفاء he mentioned that. طيب قال المؤلف رحمه الله بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. The author started by saying بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. معناه الباء حرف جر واسم مجرور بالباء. الجار والمجرور في اللغة العربية يحتاجان أن يتعلقا بشيء. بأيش يتعلقان؟ هنا متعلقهما محذوف. ما ذكرناه لكنه مقدر تقديره أبتدئ أو ابتدائي أو أصنف على حسب ما يقدر المصنف الذي كتب أو قال على حسب ماذا يقدر في قلبه. الشيخ المؤلف قال متعلقان بفعل محذوف تقديره أبتدئ. هو صرح أنه قدر أبتدئ عندما كتب هذه البسملة. This book starts with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, which means I start by the name of Allah, who is ar-Rahman and ar-Rahim. Now, the term I start is not mentioned in Arabic. So as if you say by the name. The author said himself that he meant I start. Now someone else might intend my starting. A third one might intend my authoring. ولو قدر المقدر أصنف بدل أبتدئ لكان أعم، لأن معناه أن كل التصنيف بسم الله ليس فقط الابتداء. Now if someone intends I author by the name of Allah, this would be more general. Why? Because this has the meaning that all what I write is by the name of Allah. It's not that only my start or what when I start It depends on the person who says Bismillah or who writes it. It depends on his or her intention. What does the person intend when he says that? When you stand up and you say Bismillah, it means this act of mine is by the name of Allah. When you walk and you say Bismillah, it depends. Either you intend my start is with the name of Allah or my walking is by the name of Allah. It depends on the intention of the person. Wallah, هو الخالق الإله المستحق للعبادة. Allah is the creator who deserves to be worshipped. الرحمن معناه الكثير الرحمة للمؤمنين والكافرين في الدنيا وللمؤمنين في الآخرة. الرحمن means the one who is merciful to both believers and non-believers in this life and only to the believers in the hereafter. الرحيم معناه الذي يرحم المؤمنين في الآخرة. As for الرحيم, it means the one who is merciful to the believers in the hereafter. قال المؤلف الحمد لله رب العالمين الحي القيوم المدبر لجميع المخلوقين. The author said, praise be to Allah, the Lord of the humans and jinn, the one who is attributed with life, the one who does not need anything, and the one who manages all the creations. شرح ذلك أن بسم الله كما قلنا معناه أبتدئ بسم الله. The explanation, as we said, Bismillah means I start with the name of Allah. ولفظ الجلالة الله علم للذات المقدس المستحق لنهاية التعظيم وغاية الخضوع. فإذا لفظ الجلالة الله علم, اسم علم للذات المقدس الذي لا أحد غيره يستحق نهاية التذلل, المستحق لغاية الخضوع لنهاية التذلل. The term Allah is the name of the self that deserves to be worshipped, and no one other than him deserves to be worshipped. معنى لفظ الجلالة, معنى الله الموصوف بالإلهية. The meaning of the term Allah is the one attributed with Godhood, with Al-Ilahiyya, with Al-Ilahiyya. ومعنى الإلهية القدرة على الاختراع, أي على إبراز الشيء من العدم إلى الوجود. The meaning of that, what's the meaning of Al-Ilahiyya? It means the power to create, to bring things from the state of non-existence to the state of existence. هكذا فسره أبو الحسن الأشعري رضي الله عنه. This is how الإمام أبو الحسن الأشعري explained the term Allah. He said, this is what it means. بعض العلماء قالوا الإله معناه المستحق لغاية التذلل. صحيح هذا التفسير مشهور معروف، لكن أبو الحسن الأشعري تفسيره أحسن. كلا التفسيرين لا بأس به، لكن تفسير الأشعري أحسن، فيه زيادة فائدة، لأن تفسير الأشعري معناه أنه هو وحده الخالق الذي يبرز من العدم إلى الوجود، إذن هو وحده المستحق للعبادة، فيه زيادة فائدة. Some other scholars explained the term الإله by saying it means the one who deserves the ultimate submission. It is okay to interpret it like that. And this is famous. This interpretation is famous. But Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari said Al-Ilah or Allah is the one who is attributed with the power of creating. He is only attributed with the power of creating. He is the only one attributed with the power of creating. And this is why the interpretation of Al-Imam Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari is better than the other one, because it contains an extra benefit. When you say Al-Ilah means the only one who is attributed by creating, this means that he is the only one who deserves to be worshipped. والرحمن كما ذكرنا الكثير الرحمة للمؤمنين والكافرين في الدنيا وللمؤمنين في الآخرة. والرحيم أي الكثير الرحمة للمؤمنين. الرحمن and الرحيم already we mentioned their interpretations. الرحمن is the one who is merciful to the believers and non-believers in this life and to the believers only in the hereafter. Ar-Rahim is the one who is merciful to the believers in the hereafter. فإذا قلت بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم كأنك تقول أبتدئ بسم الله الذي لا خالق غيره لشيء من الأشياء ولا أحد غيره يستحق أن يعبد. الكثير الرحمة للمؤمنين والكافرين في الدنيا والذي يرحم المؤمنين فقط في الآخرة. So when you say بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, as if the meaning of that you are saying, I now start, for example, with the name of Allah, the one, the only one who deserves to be worshipped, the only one who's attributed with the power to create, the one who is merciful to the believers and non-believers in this life and to the believers only in the hereafter. ومعنى الحمد لله أننا نثني على الله ونمدحه بألسنتنا. الحمد هو الثناء باللسان. ليس كل مدح حمدا، إنما الحمد هو مدح مخصوص. فإذا الحمد هو الثناء باللسان. إذا قلنا الحمد لله يعني الثناء باللسان على الله تعالى على وجه التعظيم على الجميل الاختياري على ما أنعم ربنا به علينا من النعم من غير أن يكون ذلك واجبا عليه. هذا معنى على الجميل الاختياري. نحمد الله أي نثني على الله بألسنتنا على ما أنعم الله به علينا من النعم من غير أن يكون ذلك واجبا عليه. As for الحمد لله, it means that we are praising Allah, we praise Allah Ta'ala with our tongues for all the endowments that Allah endowed upon us without that being an obligation, of course, without that being an obligation upon Him. So, Alhamd is not any praise. It is this kind of praise. إذا كان واحد صوته جميل تمدحه بحسن الصوت ولا تقول حمدت في لغة العرب لا تقول حمدت حسن صوته لأن حسن الصوت ليس شيئا هو فعله باختياره إنما إذا أحسن إليك بنوع من الإحسان تقول حمدته على ما فعل معي فليس كل مدح حمدا إنما الحمد مدح مخصوص. So when you praise someone for having a nice voice, for example, this is not considered hamd because having a nice voice, this is not something that a good thing that he did with you, with his intention, intentionally. Allah created him with a nice voice. Allah created this nice voice for him without his intention. As if one, on the other hand, if someone helps you when you need help, then if you praise him for that help, this is considered hamd in the Arabic language. So not every praise is considered hamd. ورب العالمين معناه مالكهم. العالمون جمع عالم معناه أن الله مالك كل ما دخل في الوجود. رب العالمين means the owner of the creations. So Allah Ta'ala is the real owner of everything. Everything that enters in the state of existence is owned really by Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. وهو سبحانه الذي يدبر كل المخلوقين. أي هو الذي قدر كل ما يجري في العالم أي هو الذي جعل كل شيء على ما هو عليه هو الذي دبر كل شيء على وفق مشيئته وعلمه الأزليين And Allah تبارك وتعالى is the one who manages all the creations. That is, everything that occurs in the universe is managed by Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala according to the eternal will and to the eternal knowledge of Allah Azza wa Jal. نقف هنا. Let us stop here for this session. أحد له سؤال؟ Does anyone have a question? Do you have any questions? طيب. نعم. Without this being an obligation upon Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Because Allah is not obligated to do anything. There is It is not like Al-Mu'tazila said. Al-Mu'tazila, they said Allah is obligated to do what's best for us. And this is blasphemy. Allah is not obligated to do anything. This is one of the blasphemous statements of Al-Mu'tazila. Al-Mu'tazila qalu, Allah يجب عليه فعل الأصلح للعبد. وهذا كفر. هذه إحدى كفريات المعتزلة. بعض العلماء رد عليهم قال لو كان يجب على الله فعل ما هو الأصلح للعبد لخلقنا في الجنة. المعتزلة said It is an obligation upon Allah to do what is best for the slave. And this is blasphemy. Allah is not obligated to do anything. Now some scholars refuted them. He said, had it been an obligation upon Allah to do what is best for the slave, then Allah would have created us in paradise. Because this is what's best for the slave. ويروى عن الأشعري شيء في هذا الخصوص أيضا. الإمام الأشعري قبل كان قبل أن يصير من أئمة أهل السنة كان مدة على الاعتزال ثم تاب رضي الله عنه. الإمام الأشعري for a period of time before he became among the Imams of أهل السنة for a period of time he was among المعتزلة those deviant groups. Then he repented. قبل أن يترك الاعتزال سأل شيخه الجبائي الذي هو من مشاهير المعتزلة سأله في مسألة before he leaves out that ill conviction he asked his sheikh who is a famous one among the Mu'tazila. He asked him about a matter. قال له ماذا تقول في ثلاثة كافر ومؤمن وصبي. مؤمن يريد بذلك أنه مؤمن تقي يعني. لأن الفاسق عند المعتزلة يخرجونه من اسم الإيمان لا يقولون مؤمن عنه. المسلم إذا ارتكب كبيرة عندهم لا يعود مؤمنا ولا يصير كافرا على زعمهم يصير في منزلة بين المنزلتين وهذه من الضلالات التي لم يسبقوا إليها. He asked his sheikh al-Jubba'i he told him what do you say about three people a believer a blasphemer and a little child that is what do you say what is their status in the hereafter. قال له شيخه المؤمن في الجنه والكافر في النار والصبي ناج في الجنة. His sheikh told him, the blasphemer would be in hellfire, the believer in paradise, and the little child would be in paradise. قال له منزلة الصبي تكون كمنزلة المؤمن. He told him, would the little child be in the same rank as the other, the believer? قال لا, ذاك استحق منزلة أعلى بأعماله. He told him, no, the believer deserved a higher rank because of the good deeds that he did, which the child didn't do. قال له فيقول الصبي يا رب لما لم تحيني حتى أعمل مثل ما عمل فأكون في منزلته, لأنه على حسب قولهم يجب على الله أن يفعل ما هو الأصلح للعبد. He told him, الأشعري told his sheikh, but then the little child would say, oh Allah, why didn't you give me a longer life so I would do good deeds like the other one, so I would be in his status also. Because according to them, they claim that it is an obligation upon Allah to do what's best for the slave. قال له شيخه, يقال له لأنك لو علم الله أنك لو بلغت لكفرت بعد ذلك, ففعل ما هو الأصلح لك أماتك قبل البلوغ. His sheikh told him, he would be told that Allah knew eternally that if you grow up, you will become a kafir. So that's why Allah made you die before reaching puberty, which is best for you. قال الأشعري فيقول الكافر يا رب فلما لم تراعي مصلحتي كما رعيت مصلحته. فانقطع, خبس, ما كان له جواب. الأشعري told him, but then the blasphemer would say, oh Allah, why didn't you make me die before puberty like you did with the little child then? And that would be better for me, best for me. That sheikh didn't know how to answer. He kept silent. Because the base from which he started is an ill creed. There is nothing, Allah is not obligated to do anything. Of course, whatever Allah does is for a wisdom, whether we know it or not. But Allah is not obligated to do anything. أحد عنده سؤال؟ أي عمر؟
Go ahead. About the in reference to the scholars about the different opinions about the small sins.
Yes.
Meanness. Could you explain that to me? I didn't get all of that. The minority of the Salaf, they said that the prophets don't commit sins at all.
Some, yes, not even an act of dislikeness.
Most of the scholars,
you know, most said the opposite.
Okay.
They said even قالوا حتى عندما حتى ما يروى عن نبي من الأنبياء من أنه فعل فعلا مكروها هذا يكون للتعليم. قالوا فيكون مثابا فيه, يعني يكون فعله ليعلم الناس أنه جائز جوازه, وهكذا قالوا. They said even if the prophet does something which is disliked, then that would be to teach the people that it is permissible to do it. So the prophet would be rewarded for that. This is what they said. This is what they said. نعم, مين كان بده هو؟ اتفضل. هذا سنأتي إليه، سيمر معنا إن شاء الله. وفيك. لا أذكر، لكن كلما مررنا على اسم إن شاء الله أبين. الرحمن والله لا يجوز إطلاقهما على غير الله، والرازق والرزاق وذو الجلال والإكرام والخالق والخلاق، كل هذه مما لا يجوز إطلاقه على غير الله. سليم. إيه دبز in Arabic because it has an extra letter, and the Arab linguists, they said when there is an extra letter in the word, two words from the same route and one of them has an extra letter, so this reflects an extra meaning. Yes. وفيكم. And it is narrated from some of us salaf also, but linguistically yes it has. Hey Khalid, I said we will cover it. Mizzi بالقرن الخامس على ما أذكر، بالقرن الخامس.
القرن الخامس.
وفيك. أو يكون السادس، الخامس أو السادس الهجري. نعم نعم. لا، إذا قلت حمدت الله هنا خصصت الحمد بالله، تستعمل في حق المخلوق بمعنى الثناء باللسان على الجميل الاختياري. وفيك. فلولا نفر من كل طائفة منهم فرقة ليتفقهوا في الدين. طيب بارك الله بكم. لا تسي لا إله إلا الله، لا إله إلا الله، لا إله إلا الله، لا إله إلا الله، اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد.